Views and opinions of any of the guests of After Hours AM are not necessarily the views and opinions of After Hours AM, its hosts, its staff, or any of its affiliates.
Broadcasting live from the After Hours AM studio, Joel Sturgis and Eric
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this edition of After Hours AM. And tonight we talk about dirty deeds done dirt cheap. That's right. It's the criminal code After Hours AM. And I'm your host, Joel Sturgis, right along with me,
Eric Olsen and
Dr. Clarissa Cole.
Oh, Clarissa. First, I want to say something quick. I watched the movie Passengers last night.
Oh.
And I want to get this out in the open right away. See, generally, I steer away from space movies that don't have star in the title, like Star Wars, Star Trek. I generally don't veer that way, but I want to make sure to bring this up to the top because everyone said, it's such a good movie. You'll love it. It was pretty good. I will say Chris Pratt, which happens to be a hometown boy, grew up and born right in Virginia, Minnesota, where I am sitting right now. And he did great. Of course, what is the girl's name for Hunger Games? That's escaping me.
Jennifer Lawrence.
There it is. I almost said Jennifer Garner for some reason. She did a wonderful job in it. Yes, it was worth seeing. You guys can stop pestering me on Facebook now. I have seen the movie, and it is decent. It's decent. I mean, it's all right. I mean, you know, it should have a star in the name, though, and I would have watched it earlier. I'm sorry. And I also did watch Doctor Strange. Yes, I did. And that was actually very, very well put together. Very, very good.
I did too. What a coincidence.
I want his cape. I want his cape so bad.
I like that one. Actually,
we watched it too.
I enjoyed that more than the normal Marvel flick.
I liked it a lot.
Yeah, I was surprised I liked as much as I did because I used to read the comics. He was never a main character in the comics. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it wasn't really like your Wolverine or your, you know, or your Hulk. He was more of a side. Yeah, I mean, he was always in a league, or he was always someone, you know, with somebody. This actually tells his story, and quite honestly, I found it very, very interesting, you know, for a Marvel movie, for a fascination movie, you know, in the fantastic realm of the paranormal, supernatural, where magic is around. I kind of thought about it as maybe just a grown-up Harry Potter there for a minute. But yeah,
Have you guys seen Logan?
Yes, I did. Yeah. We did see Logan. And okay. It was actually really good. I mean, it's
dark.
It's very dark, very dark. Is it worth $10 to get in or $15 depending upon where you live? Eric, would you say it's a $15 go see it live movie or do you think it's DVD quality?
Well, I'm trying to think. Is there anything particularly gained by the theatrical experience?
Not really.
Through some bloodletting? Come on.
Well,
there's a lot of gruesome bloodletting.
Very gruesome.
Nowhere near as bad as Deadpool was.
Oh, that's fair.
As far as the grittiness and the and the swearing and actually,
but not much humor. And the humor I find of Deadpool kind of leavens all
it did. It kind of made it, tolerable.
The violence.
Yeah, it helped the palate, you know, take all the violence that was in there, you know, without you going, oh my God, that's grotesque and horrible. That's hilarious. So that's what that movie did. It was a show a grotesque, horrible thing and then make you crack up the next second. And so that kind of evened that out, like Eric had said, kind of made it a little easier on your visual palette, so to speak.
I think it's because it had the kids, though. You know what I mean? Like, it wasn't funny, but I think because that there were the kids in that kind of softened the element a little bit. And honestly, okay, full disclosure, there's a scene. I'm not going to tell people what it is because I don't want to ruin it. You guys will know. You've seen the movie. I cried.
During Wolverine? Aww. Yeah. I mean,
during Logan.
There is. We already did a spoiler alert last week, and we already told everybody the dude's dead. But, they're already talking about bringing him back.
Neener, neener, neener.
Yeah, they're already talking about bringing him back already. The ink hasn't even dried. Yes, they're actually already.
Come on.
Because, now get this, it was the biggest, like Eric and I talked about, and Eric, you hit the nail right on top of the head. I went back and looked, and you're absolutely correct. The largest Marvel opening of all time.
What?
Yes.
No, Logan?
Yes, that was the largest opening a Marvel movie ever had, was Logan.
I never would have guessed that. Never.
Yeah, Eric.
It was also the biggest opening of any movie so far this year, which is still young, but nonetheless, that's a pretty big deal. So the question is what lesson do you learn? Do you learn the lesson that R-rated superhero movies are the way to go? I mean, is that the lesson you learn combining that with Deadpool? Or is it more break the what has become really a rather, let's face it, tedious formula for most superhero movies? So what is the lesson?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think that with the R rating, though, I mean, yes, it's gorier all that, but I do think that it draws in a different subset of people sometimes because the themes are more adult and the humor isn't as, I guess, cheesy, for lack of a better word. So, like, I went to see Logan with some people that normally wouldn't go to see Marvel films.
It was a well-acted, it was a well-acted, well-put-together film. Patrick Stewart did wonderfully playing, Dr. Xavier that's going into madness, I guess, dementia, and really playing that part because that's hard for an actor to pull that disability off, and he did it very, very well. And then, of course, the sequences of action were way cool when they were there, and there was a lot of them, but then the lows were also equally as low. So you felt the humanity of Logan rather than just the killing machine that Wolverine.
It wasn't cheesy. It wasn't cheesy.
No, because that Wolverine was Weapon X. He was only developed to kill. That is why they developed Weapon X. And so to have him, if you want to go into the Marvel lore, have him now have feelings and a heart and, oh, my gosh, I am mortal after all. You know, and that's something that he had a grip with in the movie. So you got to see the movie. You haven't seen it yet. Go see it. You know, don't listen to us. Go see for yourselves and forget the spoiler we just threw out there again. So just go out there and read it. Now, I was kicking around the old internet there, and I was on Twitter looking at a few other things, and I happened across, you're going to love this, Eric. There's one guy in the universe that keeps True Crime Wednesday going more than anybody else ever, beyond us, of course, and that is Florida Man. Florida Man has his own Twitter account. And I'm going to give you guys some headlines from Florida Man. Evidently, Florida Man's a very busy, busy criminal. And it's enough to fill an entire Twitter page. So, number one, are you aware, Eric, you are a musician, of who the Nickelback drummer is?
Well, I know he's the guy in the band who usually sits in the stool in front
generally,
of the drums.
You'll enjoy this.
Do I know
this.
His name?
No. Nobody knows his name. So this is why this is funny. Police say Nickelback drummer victim of fraud by Port St. Lucius man. He stole the Nickelback drummer's identity to allegedly try to purchase $25,000 in musical equipment. But the worst part was that he showed up, no one knew who he was.
Oh, God. That's bad for Florida and Nickelback. Come on.
Well, come on. You know, there's two kind of people that are Nickelback fans. Those that lie about it and closet, and those that actually like them out in front. Who doesn't like the Nickelback once in a while? You know that you stopped and you ran, you rocked out to Nickelback in the old car at least once or twice.
No, I changed the state. Something about Chad Kroeger's voice. I'm very sorry. I can't
what?
Do it. Yeah. You know what, though? Yeah. He sang a song, the Santana one, the one he has with Santana, I think it was.
Or is that Rob Thomas you're thinking of?
Rob Thomas was supposed to do it, but he couldn't, so he had to get Chad Kroeger to sing the vocals.
Okay. Because Nickelback, they had How You Remind Me. That was also a huge hit, and that was like out forever and wouldn't go away. And then, of course.
All right, I have to speak here.
Yes, you speak. I'm waiting for the musician of the three of us to speak up.
I'm keeping my tone low. I am actually the human being who began the Nickelback is subhuman, and it rolled on from there.
What?
All the way back. Yeah. I had unrealistic.
That was you, huh?
Unreasonable animosity toward them from the beginning.
Why?
Yeah.
Why?
I do not know. Something about that voice.
Jeez,
just
something. You know, this is How You Remind Me.
It's a combination.
Never made it as a poor man. Never made it as a rich man stealing.
And I'm talking early on when they first came out. It was this weird combination of unearned arrogance.
But they're from Canada, eh?
And you know, the fact that they're Canadian. No, I love a lot of. That part's completely false because I really actually love lots of Canadian.
That's right. Network up there in Canada that carries this Canadian.
when you look at as a proportion of the population, they only have like 20 some million in Canada, and they got a
20 some million in Canada people.
They do. Wow. They really only do.
Man,
I mean, it's true. It's similar to Australia, actually. And so anyway, they have not a large number of people, and every one of them lives within 15 feet of the U.S. border. Every single
And they all Nickelback CDs in their cars.
And there was just something about that voice, this kind of implied arrogance, and the fact that they were just another post-grunge band that sounded
that
like
true
so
now.
Many
you know,
other
you,
post-grunge
you,
bands.
You know.
And I just had to say, oh my goodness.
What are you going
to
do, Eric?
They must be subhuman.
Eric, what are you going to do when they make it to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame?
Oh, they won't.
What are you going to do when that day comes and they're up there going,
we would like to. Animosity. This poor, in fact, it's come full circle. Now, there's such unreasonable dislike of them. I don't hate them. I really don't. They're just another band. They were never nearly as good as they thought they were, and they were never nearly as good as a certain set of fans thought they were. That's what the problem was.
Well, that is true.
This whole thing about Nickelback just being the worst band that ever was, well, of course they're not. Obviously, they're not.
No, there's worse
the worst
bands
band that ever was. They may be one of the worst bands that became as popular as they did. That's the problem.
But here's the deal. It's the haters.
It's unearned popularity. That's what pisses people off.
It's the haters, though, that keep them going, that keep them in the forefront. It really is. It's
a meme. You're right. You know? Hating Nickelback, bagging on Nickelback has become a meme, and now it's just a cliche.
So
they're
forever.
Anymore. I'm not going to put them down. There's millions of other people who put them down. I don't have to, but I do have to tell you, as a music radio DJ, way back when did they come out? Were they all the way back to the 90s?
They formed in 1995 in Hanna, Alberta, Canada. The band composed of guitarist, lead vocalist Chad Kroeger, guitarist, keyboard, and backing vocals Ryan Peak, bassist Mike Kroeger, and drummer Daniel Adar. The band went through a few drummers.
They weren't called Nickelback until 2000.
That is true, but get this now, little fun fact: Nickelback is one of the most commercially successful Canadian groups that has ever sold 50 million albums worldwide, ranking just behind the Beatles as the most successful foreign rock and roll act.
Foreign where?
Well, meaning they're from Canada. They talk about American. American money.
Have they really sold that many?
They have. According to them, they have sold more than 50 million albums worldwide, ranking as the 11th best-selling music act and second best-selling foreign act in the U.S. in the 2000s behind only the Beatles.
What about Rush?
Well, Rush! evidently they flushed Rush. And Neil Peart,
All right, so let's, now that we are talking about this, which I don't know.
I know how this happened.
Oh, I do. You.
I did. I brought up the Nickelback drummer, allegedly.
Now that we're really digging deeply into it, the problem all along with them isn't really the absolute nature of their music. They're just kind of another band. And I'm sure within that style, there's songs that are perfectly competent, songs that are even perhaps catchy. The problem is they've always been way too popular for their own good.
Well, that is true. That is true.
So the people who don't really like them go, what are you talking about? They're the second biggest selling foreign band in the OOs. That's absurd.
Well, okay. Well, before.
Wait.
So that's what people don't like. And
it's because
they
don't fit into a genre too, though. They're not like a rock band, but they're not a pop band. They're like a pop band. They're pop.
You know, they were big.
Everybody says is a rock band.
Where they were big, working in radio as long as I have now, I can remember as someone that had to put up with this crap. I remember they were big about the same time Limp Bizkit was big. And do you remember the Limp Bizkit experiment that never was, or at least we wish never was, the rock rap crap they had out for a while?
Sure.
Kind of that same ilk, that same time they kind of hit, you know, together and all that kind of good stuff. Back when Slim Shady, Eminem was actually edgy, that is when they actually maybe possibly could have had a niche. But now it's, like Eric had said, it's become a meme. You compare everything bad to Nickelback now. And what that does is keep it in the consciousness of us, of the populace. And that's why they keep famous and popular. Okay, well, moving on before we all explode, wondering how Nickelback got so popular out of nowhere. Florida man with suspended driver's license seen fleeing traffic accident on a lawnmower.
Yeah. I think that's happened in Wisconsin, too. I'm not going to lie.
Just think about that for a second. You don't have a driver's license, so what do you grab? You'll grab the old snapper lawnmower, and you go down to the bar.
That must be Bud.
David,
I can hear him from three blocks away.
David Dixon of Fort Pierce allegedly ran a stop sign, and you got it on his lawnmower when he struck another vehicle. Get rid of that. God, you gotta love it when they just throw those things out of nowhere, you know, where you click on a link and they give you a video. But anyhow, he ran into a bicyclist while he was running his stop sign.
How?
He was drunk.
Was he drunk?
He was drunk, and he was coming back from the bar on his trusty old Johnny Deere and failed to stop at a stop sign and plummeted headlong into a 53-year-old cyclist.
How'd the cyclist not see/slash hear him?
Well, that is true. You would think that he would hear the buzz of a John Deere coming at you, you know, and the impending doom noise. You'd think he might hear that. But then again, this is the era of earbuds. So who knows? Maybe they did not have, maybe they had earbuds in and they were not paying attention. Maybe they're enjoying the nice Florida sunshine.
Well, we have talked about that. I mean, if it really was a case of earbuds, shame on you, 53-year-old bike rider. You should know better. Because I was going to say, what was wrong with the bike rider? Was he or she drunk also? How could you not notice a looming John Deere approaching?
Well, you would think that you would just see the deer coming at you. And you'd know, hey, that's not a good thing. A Florida man claims that he found top secret documents about North Korea crumpled underneath a restaurant table.
And then he tried to turn it into
the U.S. government for a ransom. It turned out to be completely fake, and it was written on the said restaurant menu. He hand wrote it.
Fake?
Yes, fake.
In Korean?
No,
that was industrious.
He wrote it in English. He gave it to him.
Well, what amazes me the most is he had the idea in the first
place.
Well,
that is true. I mean, that's very clever.
Wow.
That he knows anything about North Korea. That good point, actually. Yeah.
Well, here we go.
Was it written in English?
Yes, it was written in English. And not only in English, but get
that was
this.
The first clue.
Get this. It was written in brown crayon.
In English, in brown crayon.
I highly doubt the police go on to say, from the FBI actually goes on to say, I highly doubt that North Korea's going to just leave some sensitive secrets around, let alone write them in crayon and in English. The man was taken into custody and booked for fraud. Florida man.
He'd probably never seen a book before. So
well, probably not. He thought, oh,
I
cool.
think he should have seen that coming.
Florida man had to be rescued yesterday from a garbage truck after falling asleep in the dumpster. Just letting you know.
I'm glad they rescued him.
And this is all one guy. Florida man is just one
it's
guy.
It's just one guy.
Who does
okay, get this, this, get this, get this. Florida man says he committed $7 billion in bank fraud because Jesus
gets around.
Because Jesus wanted to make him rich.
Aw.
Oh, really?
So nice.
Oh my God!
Did you see the Florida man? Because I had to click on this one because and I burst out laughing. The one where the lawyer's pants catch on fire.
Exactly. Yes.
During an arson trial.
Yes. Yes. In fact, that is on the Twitter feed. And if you don't believe that there's a Florida man Twitter feed, you guys all have to go over there and take a pic.
Oh, go ahead.
Take a peek at it, of course, after the show. And read all the hijinks that our good friend Florida man's been up to.
All right, but we need to, I imagine we only have 9 minutes before the bottom of the hour, but coming into the next half hour, we're going to get into that, more of that true crime news. We need to refer people to Clarissa's Twitter feed.
Yes, before we go to the gritty down in the dumps, kind of make you feel like you have to take a shower headlines, I'm trying to make you all laugh, because we're going to scare the hell out of you. I'm just saying, just warning you now.
And that one guy, just think, if they got rid of Florida man, Florida would be crime free.
Okay, now let this headline just sink into your minds for a second. Florida man beats off alligator with butter.
Wait, what? No, no.
That's
no,
actually wait. Written in The Guardian.
Is that the headline?
That is the actual headline
yes,
from The Guardian.
Someone was paid to write that headline.
Florida man beats off alligator with butter. Now, it goes
wow.
on now.
Where do we go with Tony that on Art- family radio?
Tony Artis tells local TV, it's a good thing I beat the alligator off of my butter. He looked angry and he was charging at me. So what did I do? I whipped it out and beat him with it.
Hardly seems like a meal for the gator.
I beat him till he was done. And then he ran.
This guy had to know. I'm sorry.
Not that I would know this, but one time someone told me that is exactly the plot of a porn film.
Beating off an alligator?
With your butter.
With your butter. But then to actually put that into print, I mean, did they not proofread that day's edition? You know?
The editor didn't care.
You can order that film from that headline.
Yeah. Don't Google that headline, folks. I don't know what you're going to get. You may get a whole lot of what you weren't bargaining for.
Yeah. Oh, putters, things being beaten off, gators. Good God, man. Only in Florida.
You would think so. That and falling asleep at dumpsters. But that is really your
Maybe
Florida.
Louisiana, I suppose.
Yes. Let's see. One more from Florida man. Florida man with a gun in a car hands a joint to the cops while parked in Whole Foods handicap spot.
Here, hold this for me.
Yeah, hold this for me. Now, Mr. Nice officer friendly. You're a great guy. Will you hold this joint for me while I get out the proper credentials for you? You know, feel free to take a puff.
Maybe he was just passing it. He was being polite.
Well, maybe. It very well could
be. Don't Bogart it.
Well,
you know. Kutchy on the left-hand side.
Well, you know, Eric, now that you are, you know, well away from the 70s, did you ever smoke the devil's lettuce?
What?
Ever?
Ever. Did you?
Well, my goodness, hasn't everyone?
So now, when in the see now, the reason why I bring this up is you would think this headline would happen in the 1970s, not 2017. You see what I'm saying?
One would imagine. Although it would be hard to picture in any era not being really true.
And the reason why I bring that up is because, I mean, my Lord, that's something you'd picture in the 70s, right? Cheech and Chong, you know, back in those days where it was a little more, I don't want to say accepted, but a little more humorous, those kind of jokes. Now these people are just morons.
Classic Cheech and Chong line. What do you guys want? Remember the cop? It was a Keech. It was Stacy Keach's brother. Remember the cop? Mm. And the van is on fire.
Yes.
And the van itself is actually made of cannabis. So it's on fire, blowing in the cop's face.
All right.
And by the time they finally pull over, what do you guys want?
Well, listeners just said it's not fair of me to ask if you smoke the devil's lettuce without asking Dr. Clarissa Cole if indeed she smoked the devil's lettuce.
I went to college.
They're very quick on the show. They want to know.
Yeah, I went to college once. Yeah, but like for, you know, a while. So
okay,
I've never heard it called the devil's lettuce though. That's
a new one to me. For me as well. I mean, the response would be, well, I was once less old than I am now. There's your answer. That's all you got to know. You don't even have to go to college.
Exactly. I was in college once as well, so you can put that together. But yes. But Florida man, I'm just laughing at some of these headlines as I'm going that just are not appropriate for radio. You know, just cannot read them.
Leading off with the putter.
Well, you know, I was actually teetering that line. But Florida man dresses 13-foot alligator novelty hat and sunglasses for Halloween, then gets arrested for animal cruelty.
Oh, my.
Aw. What, did the gator like it, though?
No, according to this little snippet here, and they're showing a video of this, the gator was not very happy.
The gator had a big grin on his face.
Yes,
he always does.
Huge grin. But that is your Florida man for the week. Oh. Thank God.
For the week.
I swear my IQ
gets around.
My IQ just plummeted 20 points reading this. I feel a little bit dumber.
You know, somehow Nickelback ended up in Florida. From Canada.
Somehow the drummer from Nickelback tried to go get himself $25,000 worth of recording or musical stuff, but they didn't even know who he was. That's the funny part. And they're musicians in these stores. It's a guitar center. Can you imagine how that went over? You know, you might as well said you're Jimi Hendrix. At least someone would have said.
Since we have like another minute or so before the break, I did want to sort of conclude my easing up on Nickelback because it's not really particularly fair. How much people hate them and abuse them. My son, who's 13, never heard a Nickelback song, never heard a Nickelback, but he is Mr. Interwebs, right? So he gets all the memes, and he came up to me the other day, and he goes, "My God, Dad, why does everyone hate Nickelback so much? Are they like Nazi child rapists or what?" I go, "No, they just, you know, they just, well, they kind of suck."
Well, Rockstar was a pretty good song. Come on.
I want to say, the analogy is, and you guys aren't as old as I am, so it won't ring quite as true probably, but after Peter Frampton's Frampton Comes Alive, the classic live album, right? And for a number of years, up until Michael Jackson's Thriller, for several years, it was the biggest selling album.
Yes, it was. It was huge.
Frampton Comes Alive. And so at first, of course, people get all excited about it. Ooh, this is great. I've discovered this. Because Frampton wasn't that big a name. I mean, he'd been around, but he wasn't that big a name prior to that album. But then you had, obviously, of course, the inevitable backlash because people are going, Peter Frampton, why does he have the biggest selling album of all time? So for years and years and years, people just hated him for no particular reason other than he had this quote unquote unearned biggest selling album of all time for a few years. And I think that's exactly why people feel the way they do about Nickelback. It's nothing really about them. It's the fact that they are so big selling and people don't get it.
Really quick, I got one more to input to you, and this one comes from one of our listeners over here on Facebook. They're fast blasting me or PMing me over Facebook. This one comes from Jack, and Jack says, hey, I'm roughly Eric's age, maybe a little bit older, but I only have to tell Eric one thing, and he'll know what I'm talking about, dancing on the ceiling for hatred.
Oh, yes, and the video, oh my Lord.
Was it truly that bad?
What?
No, I mean, no, it's not. That's the point. Lionel Richie, and there was such a tremendous backlash against the poor guy. Part of it was that song was out of character. It was more of a dance number, an up-tempo dance number, and all of his other huge hits from that era were more like ballads.
Yeah, exactly.
Mid-tempo. So the fact that he's doing this kind of hokey dance on the ceiling, I mean, it was perfectly feasible, reasonable pop song, nothing particularly wrong with it, but it was a silly, silly video, and, you know, they're using all the camera tricks to show people dancing on the ceiling. Sure. And the song, I mean, I don't mind it at all, really. But yeah, good point. Very good point. Tremendous backlash because of it was just too big. People have this sense. If you are too big, we're going to chop you down. We're going to cut you down to size.
Yes, that is very, very true. We got to run the break, though. When we come back, we dive headlong into the gritty. The very, very gritty true headlines. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back right after this. Hey, you listen to After Hours AM, and if you're listening to us via podcast, make sure you like us, follow us, review us, tell your friends about us, tell grandma about us, and keep listening.
It's your ideas, work, and creativity that make it your yard. At Ace, we're here to help with hoses and sprinklers to nurture growth, gardening tools for the shape of good things to come, even the right fertilizer and bug killers to make the grass a little greener. You'll find it all now at Ace, your place, with everything you need for your yard, plus helpful advice, almost like we're right there. Ace,
the helpful place.
Anavar Media LLC is a dedicated team of professionals committed to helping business development scale and protect their websites, mobile applications, enterprise software solutions in the Northeast Ohio area. Locally owned since 2012, our client-centered values truly sets Anavar apart. Contact us today to learn how you can get 25% off your first project. Call them at 234-380-4852. Again, that's 234-380-4852. Or visit them at www.anavar.com. Again, that's www.anavar.com.
Hi, I'm Kip Parker.
And I'm Charlie Parker.
And we're the Parker Brothers. Hey, Charlie, what's missing from our game catalog?
I don't know, Kip, tell me.
Well, you can't talk to the dead.
You sure as hell can.
That's why we got this brand new game called Ouija.
Ouija? Well, break that down for me.
Well, it's Wii because you're having a great time. And G, it's because G, aren't you having a blast because you're having a good time with the Wii.
It looks like it smelled like a Chinaman got caught in there.
Don't question it.
Well, Ouija, Kip, tell me about it.
Well, inside the package comes a flat board with all the letters of the alphabet, numbers from 0 to 9, and a yes, no written out by itself.
Well, that sounds like a lot of stuff going on.
It's got a lot of stuff going on indeed, Charlie. It also comes with this planchette, which hovers over the letters the dead are trying to tell you.
Well, how does that work, Chip?
Well, you ask the question, and then the dead move your hands in the direction of the answers.
That sounds like a heck of a way to find Grandpa's slave money.
Turns out it was in the attic. But the questions don't have to be as serious as slavery. You can also find out if Sally's got a crush on you. The dead like to answer all sorts of trivial questions.
Feels like they'd have better things to do with their time, Kip.
No, lost souls are lost forever, and they're really glad to help.
Well, gee, Kip, can't you just get any sort of board with numbers and letters and talk to the dead?
The dead prefer quality like anybody else. Quality you can only find at Parker & Parker.
The Ouija board, brought to you by the Parker Brothers, available in both white and colored Walworths. Separate but equal savings.
You're listening to After Hours AM, the best in alternative talk radio. Got a question, comment, guest suggestion, or just want to say hi? Contact us at afterhoursam@gmail.com. That's afterhoursam@gmail.com. Want to call the show and be interactive? That's easy. The number is 612-326-6874. Again, the number is 612-326-6874. And thank you for listening.
You're dead! I saw you die!
I was faking. I used ninja focus to slow my heart rate down.
What are you doing?
I'm burying you.
I'm alive, Brandon, I'm alive!
You're waking the neighbors! No. Shut up!
No!
Now I'm gonna play your drums.
Help me.
Welcome back to After Hours AM, the only show that introduces Eric to the devil's lettuce. Mwah! We are back.
I have to admit, I have never heard that phrase
before.
I believe Clarissa said the same thing.
Yeah, like, what?
The devil's lettuce. Yeah, it's pretty commonly known amongst the kids. Yeah, I'm hip like that. What can I say?
The youth of today?
The youth of today, that's right. The devil's lettuce. Yeah, they clued me in on the whole thing. But
we are the band, our band, you know, the props. We played at a graduation party for the young folk.
The youngins?
Yes. And we ended up with this bizarre ritualistic chant where everyone there under 21 was nuding up, taking their clothes off.
Damn.
Rolling around in Crisco. And we were all chanting, "Youth of today! Youth of today! Youth of today! And so apparently what that meant to them was
go
take
nuts.
All my clothes off and roll around in Crisco.
Evidently. Last time I saw something like that, it was Nelly was hot, and it was, "It's hot in here, so take off all your clothes."
Yes.
And so I was at a... I was at a disco years ago. It was, well, I shouldn't say disco. My God, I'm not even that old. I'm calling it a disco. It was
disco.
Where people dance, you know. And
a dance club.
A dance club. And it was a radio event, and they had hired the radio station I was working for to go DJ it, I guess. And, of course, that song comes on. It was for college kids. Man, I saw more nudity in college bodies than I had seen in the previous 30 years I've been on the earth, 31 or 32 at that point, years I've been on the earth. Oh, my God, the debauchery, it was great.
You never know when all hell is just going to break loose. In my DJ days, I'm talking about live DJing, way back in the 80s in Southern California. Oh, my God. I used to DJ fraternity and sorority parties. And this was in the 80s when things, before there were so many rules as there are now.
Yes, yes.
I saw debauchery almost every evening.
Wow, well, you know, there's nothing wrong with a good dose of debauchery, and we got that for you right here in the way of true crime headlines, as read by the beautiful and talented and sweet Clarissa Cole.
Check out her Twitter feed.
Yeah,
send
go to her
Twitter feed, Clarissa.
author_Clarissa. You can check out all of these headlines, and some of these were picked specifically for tonight, because this first one that I want to get to really keys into what we're going to talk about with Alan. It is a Houston boy, 7 years old. He was hit with a belt 62 times by his mother's boyfriend. So on February 16th of this year, Cordero Williams, 27 years old, of Houston, pulled his car to an illegal dumping site. He got this kid out of his girlfriend's car, and he beat him with his belt over 62 times. But here's the kicker. This was caught on camera only because the cops had put up a camera there because people were illegally dumping so much trash.
No kidding. Oh,
so they wanted to figure it out. So that's how it was caught. So my question to you guys is, should this brings up the whole issue of like CCTV, right?
Yeah.
Like they have in London. I mean, this guy probably wouldn't have been caught.
Well, true, but you know, is it worth, and I hate to be the guy that will probably get yelled at, but is it worth it to the expense of the rest of our privacy? That one person acts up, quite honestly, but does that give them the right to track me when I'm a law-abiding citizen?
I mean, it does. It brings up that sort of issue for me. But, you know, to see part of the video of this occurring with a seven-year-old kid, it just, it's heartbreaking that anybody could do that to a child. And one of the case we're going to talk about tonight involves some pretty horrible child abuse. So what thoughts does that bring up?
What is the law right now? Is it state by state? Is it municipality? What is the law right now regarding use of closed circuit TV?
That's a good question. I don't know. I actually don't know what it is.
Well, I do know that I have read a lot of news stories over the years about different communities going to CCTV on their main streets, things like that. And of course, you should not. The standard law enforcement basically slogan is you should have no expectation of privacy in public.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that there is true. And then, of course, on a related note, the police have started to get this. They started basically watching and tracking peaceful protesters on social media.
I believe that.
They're actually wasting money now. They even went so far as to subscribe to a powerful social media monitoring tool called GoFia, whatever that is, and it's used by law enforcement to access. They can access your account and monitor exactly what you've been saying.
The problem is they don't know what they're looking for. That's what ticks me off, is that when it comes to social media now, like, okay, the Columbine killers, you know, posted things, the Texas shooter, the mass murderer just down in Orlando posted things on social media. I know housewives sitting at home with cats in their lap talking about how they want to kill the people that work at the electric company. How do you screen out which ones aren't?
Look at us getting ready for a true crime show. And what do we talk about back and forth? Heinous acts of violence. Getting ready for the show. You know, if they only got a blurb of that and they weren't seeing the whole thing in its context.
Red flags.
Exactly. We'd all be on the watch list. So, yes, I do believe that we are edging even closer to 1984.
Well, we already have traffic cams. And remember the big, huge outcry when that happened. But that didn't last very long. Those were held up. You know, those are held up in court. If you're caught on the traffic cam, that is evidence. And as far as I know, I don't know of cases where that has not been true. So I guess the difference would be in this case, it's a private closed circuit TV, right? It's not public. It's not owned and operated by the government. And so can that be used in court? I don't know. But simply to have that evidence, I get both sides of it. Clarissa, interestingly, you're the one who's responding emotionally this time rather than your typical rather dispassionate approach when you are in your professional mode. Whereas, you know, Joel is saying, well, okay, but let's look at the bigger picture. Yes, that one incident is awful. It's terrible, of course. You know, there's always going to be something awful, something that would sway you. It would be kind of like the same argument one would use if you were discussing the death penalty, for example, right? Well, what about this? What about this guy? And this guy did this and this. Well, there's horrifying, awful, terrible things. And if you have the death penalty, then, you know, it should be used in those instances. The question is, though, the greater good, societal good versus these individual cases. So, you know, I think I agree with you. I think I would rather know. Certainly, I would rather that society be able to protect this child or at least get justice for this child. It's just how much are we willing to give up? And then question beyond that is, do we have any choice? And honestly, we don't have a whole lot of choice.
Not really. And if they want to do it, they'll just do it under the radar. I mean, look at the leak that just happened, WikiLeaks, showing us how easily they can track us and listen to what we say using devices in our own home.
Well, everybody's got a cell phone nowadays, you know, anyway. So even if there isn't the CCTV, who's not going to whip out their cell phone and start taking video?
Well, exactly that. And, you know, it's easier to track us than they want us to believe. So they want us to worry and get mad about a CCTV feed, when in reality they're tracking us using their own devices on us already. So, you know, quite honestly, it's like, don't watch the right hand. We'll distract them over here to the left about the CCTV crap.
And, of course, you better not get on Barack Obama's bad side, or he will spy on you.
He will spy on you. He will
through your microwave.
You. Right through your microwave. That's right. When you're making popcorn, he'll be watching you every breath you take. Every pop that makes, he'll be watching you. Okay.
He has no more vacations to go on and smile and be happy at.
Yes, exactly. He's happy not to be president anymore. The next headline really bothers me in a lot of ways, Clarissa, and that's teen indicted in murder of classmate who was found decapitated. Why don't you take us through that headline? That's really
yes.
Dark.
So this last Monday, a 16-year-old, Matthew Borges, now 16, in Essex County, Massachusetts, he was charged with first-degree murder in connection with the grisly murder of his Lawrence High School classmate, 16-year-old Lee Manuel Valora Paulino. So Valora Paulino was last seen on November 18th of last year, but he was found decapitated on the banks of the Merrimack River on December 1st by a woman walking her dog. So Borges said he and the victim smoked pot together at the devil's lettuce. That he just left him. He was seen alive when he left him, and that's all he knew about it. If convicted, he faces life in prison. But since he's a minor in Utah, he will be eligible for parole after 20 to 30 years of that sentence. Now, the reason I brought up this story, as grisly as it is because this also relates to what we're going to talk about with Alan when it comes to minors, because there was a big uproar about this case after the fact, after the body was recovered, because they said that the police didn't handle the disappearance of Valora Paulino well. He was reported missing right away. And of course, what do the police say when you report a kid missing? What's the first thing they tell you?
Yeah, well, they say, I heard because I actually lived through it. They'll come back. Don't worry.
They ran away, right?
Yeah. Yeah. They're runaways. That is the first order of business. They treat it as a runaway. Because generally speaking, these teens full of angst, according to the police, and they show up. They have a penchant for running. And if you just let them blow a little steam off, they'll come back.
Even if they've never done it before, right?
Yes,
and they have no history of doing it.
Exactly.
And they're not juvenile delinquents. It's like, this is what makes me crazy. It's like when something happens like this and a kid disappears who has no history of disappearing, has no juvenile delinquency record, take it seriously. What do we have to do?
That's exactly it right there. I mean, that's the thing. Instead of... You know, if you got a kid that's a habitual runner, sure, I get it. Get the book out and start writing it like it normally is. Okay, I get it. That'd be the first knee-jerk reaction. But if this individual doesn't have those tendencies, why would that be your default setting?
That's the weird thing to me in that law enforcement seems to have picked this up somewhere, right? Because the statistics say that when a kid disappears, most often they are one runaway. But those are just statistics. Now, you should. I have always been taught in my job to handle every case individually, because not everybody is exactly alike. So why don't they start doing that? How hard would it be?
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. And then there's another one. Speaking of cruelty, the next headline.
May I interject?
Yes,
one
absolutely. Give us your thoughts, sir.
It just really reminds me of the importance of knowing how to use and to look at statistics. And it's so dangerous because it even gets into areas such as profiling and racism, you know, just our assumptions and prejudices about groups of people. You cannot interpolate is the word when you go from a group to an individual. You cannot reasonably interpolate. You cannot take even what may be perfectly true overall characteristics of any given group and then apply that to any one individual. You cannot do that. And really the same is true the other way. You can't extrapolate from the characteristics of one person to that of a group. So it's so important that we do. I mean, I sound like kumbaya, you know, and oh, I'm hugging that tree. Ooh, that's kind of a weird slippery elm or something. You know, I sound like a tree hugger. But, I mean, it really is true. We must take individuals as individuals and individual cases as such. And while it may always be tempting to lump people in, to lump cases in with statistics, it's never a good way to go because we're talking about individuals and we care about individuals. Mm-hmm. And remember, the United States, the foundation of this nation, it's built on the rights and responsibilities of the individual. So there.
Well said. Very well said. I'm in total agreement with you. And I think that they can be a dangerous thing, and it sets a dangerous precedent when you let stats cloud your own judgment to instead of taking a case-by-case basis. I think it's a dangerous, slippery slope. Oh, wow.
All right. Well, we all agree on that one. All right. Sorry about that. Move on.
Reward claim. Okay. Reward climbs to $40,000 for suspect who viciously beat tortured Utah cat with a hot glue gun.
I want them to catch this person so badly. It's not even funny. Plus, you listen. Okay. If you're in Utah, you literally can make $40,000. $40,000 if you can turn in the person that did this horrible thing. Sage, a six-year-old male cat belonging to a China Rose of Clearfield, Utah, went missing on March 5th. Mm-hmm. He was tortured with a hot glue gun and then beaten to death. But when they say beaten to death, that's kind of misleading because the cat actually had enough strength to crawl home to its owner before dying.
Oh,
this was horrific. She rushed the cat to the vet. The cat died. They are the Humane Society of Utah is offering a $40,000 reward for anybody who knows about this. And honestly, there's more than the $40,000 reason to turn this person in because whoever did this, this isn't the worst of it.
Oh boy.
Anybody that could do this has a lot more in store for us.
Well, you know, as we've known on this show, and we've talked about serial killers in depth, they generally generally start with animals, don't they? That is usually the first victim.
And this is such a high level of sadism, Joel. I mean, this is...
It is.
It's
reading
not that
the story,
they just killed the animal.
It's horrible.
This is terrible.
It is absolutely horrible. And I do want the person to get caught, not only because they need to face what they have come to them for what they've done, but my God, who's next, a human? I mean, how far is he going to go?
I think this might be a group of people, too, by the way.
It very well could be. It really could be. Do you think it's like a thrill deal?
I think it's maybe a group of juveniles is my guess because of what was done to the cat with the glue gun. They taped the cat's or the hot glue gun, the eyes shut. They did other things that would you'd need to be able to subdue the cat and still be able to hold the glue gun.
My Lord. See, now I'm a cat owner. And I'm not the world's biggest cat fan. I've said that numerous times. But at the same time, I pet them and I love them. And even though I don't like you, get away from me. I'm not a cat. Deep down inside, I'm a cat person. All right? I become a cat person. And that is just horrible because they're very feeling animals. They love you back. I mean, it's just like a dog or any, you know. Do you think there would be a bigger outcry if this is a dog this happened to?
I think it might. Although I've got to say, a $40,000 reward, that's pretty decent. I mean,
that is substantial.
That is some money. That I mean, it would have made the national headlines.
Yeah, I agree.
Had it been a dog, because
things have changed regarding the difference between how people, humans, view dogs and cats. You know, in the past, I mean, oh my God, you guys know about the history of cruelty to cats in Europe in particular?
It's unreal. It really is.
It's because of the association with witchcraft. Mm. It was a large part of the excuse.
And when I grew up on the farm, Eric, it was not an uncommon sight to see farmers just shooting cats.
Yeah.
You know, like they're vermin to them because there's so many of them. You know, and of course, now I've grown up and, you know, I look back at those days going, oh, my God, you should have taken the Humane Society or done something rather than just shooting them. So, yes, thank God we've come a little bit farther. You know, we still have more ways to go when it comes to charging people for animal cruelty. Sometimes it's still laughed at in court and they're still viewed a lot of times as owning property, that you could do whatever you want with your own property. And that is changing, though, in the court system. Right, Clarissa? That's getting away from that ownership rather than and going to more of a cruelty charge.
It is. It's more of a cruelty. And I'm hoping, too, that public in general is starting to recognize that when you see this horrible abuse of animals, that it extends to more than just the animal. This person is disturbed on a level where they will, if they're not already, mistreat humans, too.
Exactly.
So we have to look at it more seriously.
Exactly. You're absolutely correct. And you know, Eric, and you both brought up great points, and I'm right there with you. But the next one is kind of, it would almost fall in the dumb criminal category. I mean, I'm surprised the offender isn't from Florida, to be honest with you. Florida man, you are slacking. 12 indicted in $12 million scheme to sell stolen retail products on Amazon and eBay.
That's a lot of money. Okay, so this is why it should be. This is why it should be from Florida.
Exactly. That is a haul. That's high hopes right there.
After 10, do you know what they called it? What they called this operation to take down these horrible criminals?
I read it, but I'll let you say it.
Operation Sticky Fingers.
It's concluded 12 women and men aging. I'm going to kind of read for you a little bit. What strikes me is the age range, 22 to 64 years old. From all across the United States. I mean, how did they do it via Facebook? Did they have their meetings?
How did they recruit?
Exactly. You know, I wanted to start a cult once, and that turned out to be too hard. And that was my own hometown. I couldn't imagine recruiting people to do this kind of job.
Well, the kingpin was in his 60s. He had an alias, the General.
The General.
Yeah, he said he's done this for two decades.
The Colonel was taken.
The General's taken too, isn't it?
General Motors, Colonel Sanders. I would have to say the General might have been always spoken for. That is ridiculous. I'm only known as the General.
He was the kingpin.
My
and
gosh.
Since 2012, at least $12 million in merchandise was stolen and resold.
Where are they getting the merchandise?
Well, exactly.
That's the funny part. You want to tell them, Joel?
You know, I'm looking at it now. Let's see. I'm seeing it in PayPal accounts, Amazon accounts. Since 2012, at least $12 million of merchandise is stolen from retail stores such as Staples, Office Depot, Best Buy in 28 states, then resold on eBay and Amazon. New York Attorney General Eric Schneiderman called it one of the largest ever busts. Is this a bust or what? Very impressive, ma'am. Just want the facts. Of a retail theft ring.
Staples.
Staples. No wonder they're out of business.
How can they possibly get that kind of volume
from Staples?
Not talking about high.
Can you imagine if you want to do this at a dollar store? Here's the deal, guys. We're only gonna steal dollar store items
because we're gonna steal the whole store, and that'll still only be worth $500.
Okay, I'm thinking that it must be like maybe. I mean, this is gonna sound stupid, but like ink cartridges and stuff.
Maybe I wasn't aware that there's a black market for ink cartridges.
If there is, I'd totally.
Can you imagine that? Can you imagine that deal going down? That deal going down in a parking lot?
Yes.
No, seriously. I spend like $50 on my ink cartridges. If somebody said, "Hey, get all the ink cartridges for $10," I'd be like, "Really?"
Yeah, you'd be like, "I'm in." You know, I'm in. You know what I'm saying? I'm just telling you right there. You know, I'm just saying.
There is an aftermarket. You know, they imply strongly that you must only buy from the Hewlett-Packard only, or you will fall into a gaping hole, the gaping maw, and you'd be chewed and chowed and thrown away.
Yes,
and
your bones will be discarded into hell.
Yeah, it'll be really bad. So that, you know, they imply and they make it so difficult, but it's not. You know, and all you got to do is, you can go anywhere. Go to any online. And just put in generic, right? And then what you're looking for, all they do is squirt the ink back in them. I mean, it's not that complicated.
This is not actually true, though, because I bought a Hewlett-Packard. I'm just going to say, I bought an HP printer this last year. If I don't use HP ink cartridges, it will shut down. It won't work.
Okay, now who is really the criminal here, Clarissa? Think about it for a minute. Who's really
Hewlett-Packard?
Exactly. They're the criminal.
I'm calling
here.
You out right now. I
That's
am. You
right.
have no right
That's...
to remotely shut down my printer.
That's right.
There are ways to deal. Disable that.
We'll talk off air.
Yes, there are ways. It's called sledgehammer. That really disables a lot of things, let me tell you. Now, Eric, tomorrow night we have another edition of After Hours AM. And who's our guest tomorrow night before we move on to the main event here?
We do. And I'm actually very excited about it because it's a topic near and dear to my heart. One, in fact, that I've written about quite a bit, and that is the intersection of music and the paranormal.
Ah, so we will be having an author. Let me cut you off now. because he's excited. We're friends on Facebook. Mr. Matt Swain.
Absolutely.
Will be joining us, and we're going to be talking about haunted country music this time. We've had him on the show before talking about haunted rock and roll, but this time we're going to the byways and the highways and the honky-tonks, and he will be telling us all about haunted country music. Now, Eric, do you ever sing any country music during the prop shows? Do you ever go country?
Yeah, we do. We do. My daughter, Kristen, my oldest daughter, is actually a very, very talented country singer. She really kind of has a knack for it. I'm not really sure where it came from, but she's really good at it. And she was kind of pushing us, and we being a very eclectic, very broad bar band, and we said, man, all right, sure, we got to do country. So at any given time, we do two or three country songs.
Very, very cool. If you are in the greater Ohio area or even in Cleveland, make sure you check out the props at a bar near you.
Right now, she does such a great version of Redneck Woman, classic, Gretchen Wilson. Kristen Olsen rocks it out. Now she's 8 months pregnant, so it's very fitting.
Very, very cool.
Barefoot and pregnant, singing Redneck Woman by Gretchen Wilson.
I can't wait to talk to Matt Swain again. I mean, the first couple times we've had him on are blockbusters. I expect no different. But we got to run to Fox News. Thank you, Clarissa, so much for reading our true crime headlines this week. And we will be right back right after this.
News Radio. I'm Kathleen Maloney. President Trump takes to the stage tonight for a campaign-style rally. Fox's John Decker is live in Nashville.
President Trump's supporters have already started filing into Municipal Auditorium after waiting as long as 7 hours for the doors to open. Earlier, the president in Michigan said that he's fighting for jobs in the U.S. auto industry.
The assault on the American auto industry, believe me, is over.
A capacity-filled crowd of 10,000 expected tonight. The president planning to tout the Republican health care plan. Kathleen?
Thanks, John. The reporter who obtained documents from Donald Trump's 2005 tax return says it's possible he received them from the president himself or somebody close to him.
I have no idea where they got it, but it's illegal, and you're not supposed to have it, and it's not supposed to be leaked. And it's certainly not an embarrassing tax return at all.
The president speaking on Fox's Tucker Carlson tonight. The full interview airs at 9 p.m. Eastern time. The latest Fox News poll is a mixed bag for President Trump. Fox's Gernal Scott is live with the numbers.
Kathleen, on job performance, 51% say they disapprove of what President Trump has done so far. A majority also negative about the latest version of the travel ban, as well as what has become a hallmark of the Trump White House. Fox's director of polling, Dana Blanton.
Half of voters disapprove of President Trump's tweeting, 50%. Now 16% approve, and another 32% wish that he would be more cautious.
On the positive side, more voters feel President Trump will boost the economy and that he's worked harder than his predecessors in fulfilling campaign promises, Kathleen.
Thanks, Gernal. Stocks make some solid gains, the Dow climbing 112 points. Fox News Radio, fair and balanced. The Justice Department is bringing cybercrime charges against Russian officials in connection with a breach at Yahoo that affected at least half a billion user accounts.
Mary McCord, acting Assistant Attorney General, announced the indictment of four people, two Russian intelligence officers and two hackers.
Dmitry Dokachayev and Igor Sushchin, both FSB officers, protected, directed, facilitated and paid criminal hackers to collect information.
The Justice Department says the hackers targeted the accounts of Russian and American officials, people who worked in finance, and Russian journalists, among others. One of the suspects has been arrested in Canada. In Washington, Molly Nee Wilkes, Fox News.
Traffic is rolling again on a stretch of highway in North Dakota that's been closed for months because of protests against the Dakota Access oil pipeline. A portion of Highway 1806 was shut down in late October after a bridge was damaged by fires during those protests. It's nearby an area where the pipeline opponents camped out, but all of those camps have been cleared away. A day to dig out after Tuesday's storm that dumped piles of snow on parts of the Northeast.
We had the snow, and then we had the sleet, and then it froze. So the top layer is frozen, and it's soft, but I'm really working for my money today.
That man shoveling in New Jersey. Driving is also challenging with ice causing accidents and stalling traffic in upstate New York.
I just have to sit and wait. Been on the island since 87, so, but this is definitely the worst that I can recall.
That is the situation on the roads in Buffalo, where people are accustomed to heavy snowfall, but maybe not that much. Airlines still feeling the effects of that late winter storm. More than 1,000 flights were canceled today, on top of more than 6,000 yesterday. This according to the air tracking service FlightAware. I'm Kathleen Maloney, Fox News Radio.
Back to After Hours AM, everybody. I'm your host, Joel Sturgis, right along with me,
Eric Olsen and
Dr. Clarissa Cole.
Now, tonight, Eric, we have a really great show on tap, but it's also one that maybe back in the day, abuse was not. I just want to kind of get this out there for folks who are just tuning in. You have to understand, looking at the case we're going to discuss with 2017 eyes, are not something that you should look at it with. You should look at it in early 1980s, late 70s, where abuse was more of a it's the family's problem kind of thinking. We've come a long way, thank God, with domestic violence, things like that. But I just want to qualify that for the audience before we do our introductions, so anyone that's just now tuning in will understand that, you know, how far and appreciate how far we've come after we, you know, while we're telling this tale. So go ahead, Eric.
All right. Well, we are very excited to be speaking this evening with legendary true crime journalist Alan Prendergast about his classic book, The Poison Tree, among many other topics, chronicling the infamous Richard Jahnke child abuse and parricide case. The book was a finalist for the Edgar Award for Best True Fact Crime and has recently been republished as an ebook by Open Road Media. On a cold November night in Cheyenne, Wyoming, 15-year-old Richard Jahnke, ROTC leader and former Boy Scout, waited for his parents to return from celebrating the 20th anniversary of the night they met. When his father got out of the car, the boy blasted him through the heart with a 12-gauge pump-action shotgun. Richard's 17-year-old sister, Deborah, was sitting on the living room couch with a high-powered rifle just in case her brother missed. Oh, my. That is an intro to a book indeed. And, of course, there's plenty more if you'd like to know more in written form right on America's-most-haunted.com. Check out the article. And, of course, you can always listen to our shows live and recorded on the site. Alan Prendergast's stories about the justice system, historic crimes such as the JonBenet Ramsey case, high security prisons, and death by misadventure have appeared in a wide range of anthologies, including the True Crime Collection, Seven Sins, The Best American Crime Reporting, 2008, Best American Sports Writing, 2009. He has also written for Rolling Stone, Outside, Los Angeles Times Magazine, Men's Journal, and other national publications, and recently appeared on the CNN program, How It Really Happened, Who Killed JonBenet Ramsey. Since 1995, Prendergast has been a staff writer for the Denver newsweekly Westword. He was awarded the 2015 Eugene S. Pulliam National Journalism Writing Award by Ball State University for his article, Bloody Ludlow, which commemorated the 100th anniversary of the worst labor conflict in American history. And it was the cover story of the April 14th, 2014 issue of Westword. Welcome to the program, Alan Prendergast.
Well, thanks. What an introduction. I hope I can live up to that.
Oh, I even left some out.
Eric, you're the best in the business. Now, you know,
shucks.
I had read your work in the past, and Clarissa, Dr. Clarissa Cole reached out to you to come on the show, and I'm really glad she did. One, because you're such a talent, and two, you're not afraid to go places others sometimes don't want to go. And I don't mean the subject matter, but I mean the detail. Where when I read your stuff, I get transported there. I mean, it's so detailed. And I just want to tell you how appreciative I am for that writing style, because, you know, a lot of people that write are great in their own right, but they don't put you in the room. How did you learn this style? I mean, was it taught to you?
I mean, the Jahnke case is a good one maybe to start with, because that's a difficult kind of story to tell. It's really a story about intimate violence, I mean, inside a family, and there was a lot of questions, you know, I had as a reporter about, well, did this stuff really happen? You know, you had really different accounts of what was going on inside this house from the mother, the son, the daughter. Of course, the father wasn't around to give his side after that. But you look for things that somehow settle those questions so you can really put the reader right there. In that case, I was extremely fortunate. The girl, Deborah, had kept a diary from the age of about 7. There aren't too many, you know, young girls of that age that would record things that were going on in the house the way she did. And, you know, it was things like that, and getting the cooperation and the trust of the family that really allowed me to get, I guess, into those kind of details with some confidence, and not like, oh, this is some construct later for court, or, you know, this is some crazy story they came up with. But to be able to go back and actually find witnesses and find documents to something that was a pretty big secret, I mean, in that family for a long time, about what was going on in that house.
How long did you get to spend with them, or you know, just kind of in that environment?
I spent some months researching it. I mean, I knew a lot from the trials. I had covered the trials for Rolling Stone and had just sort of observed an awful lot of what was going on, not just in the courtroom, but, you know, sometimes, and I tell journalism students this when I teach, is sometimes you got to get out of the courtroom and see what's going on in the hallway, because that's where the real story is sometimes. And there was a lot of stuff going on around this family and conflicts with their lawyers, and I could see there was a larger story here. And so after the trials, I really approached them about doing this book, and it took a while to get to a point where they were able to talk to me without worry about, you know, their legal appeals and things like that. And then it got to be really, you know, I think I was able to roll up my sleeves and get into it in some detail. And it's really fascinating because, I mean, these were really interesting people who had been through a very traumatic situation. And they did have different ways of looking at it, and you had to sort of triangulate a bit to sort of figure out what was going on.
Well, reading the account, going back and actually reading the newspaper accounts of the case, it was really kind of a sensational case for the day. Very few cases, if any, were heard like this one was, dealing with such young children.
Well, that's the thing. Usually this kind of case would end up in juvenile court, and the press at large, they don't get into juvenile court, they don't publish the names of the juveniles. The decision was, this happened in Cheyenne, Wyoming, and the decision of the prosecutors was this was such a heinous crime, and they wanted to really send a message, I guess, that they decided to try these two as adults, even though the girl was 17 and Richard was 16. And by doing that, they put it in the public eye. And I think it was also, it got picked up by the media a lot because this was not the kind of family where you expected to have this thing going on. I mean, we know now, of course, domestic violence happens all through all strata of society.
Yeah.
But I think back then it was a novelty that, oh, wow, this happened in a really nice upper-class home. The father was a criminal investigator for the Internal Revenue Service. How could this happen in a house like that? I mean, I think that was part of the curiosity, was this was not the typical family that people, you know, associated with an abusive home environment. So it was kind of an education, I think, in seeing that, no, this goes through all strata of society.
Well,
how rare. Go ahead, Joel.
I was going to say, according to the reports, and they use the words in one. Yeah, in fact, I went to the newspaper of that town, Cheyenne, Wyoming. Unadulterated hell is what they use to talk about the Jahnke home. And that came out in court about exactly how abusive it was.
Because, you know, these things, when they do come out, it's like, wow, nobody had any idea. But in fact, lots of people had known something about what was going on. The mother was very good at keeping secrets. She was a very traditional housewife, a Puerto Rican background, sort of stand by your man kind of person. The kids, though, acted, you know, they told various people about what was going on. The fact that the father was beating the children, the fact that he was molesting the daughter, the fact that he was beating the wife in front of the children, that he was a maniac who had all these guns, made all these threats. This kind of came out over time to different people, but it was sort of dismissed. I mean, until the actual shooting of the father, a lot of people, I don't think, took these kids seriously, particularly the daughter, because she was known to sort of have this sort of exaggerated histrionic manner, and people just didn't believe her when she told some of these stories, because she told so many other wild stories. But yeah, it did. When it finally came out in court, people were saying, "Wow! I mean, this house, all this stuff was going on all this time in this nice neighborhood, and the other neighbors really didn't have a clue about it because this family was so isolated and kept to themselves. And mm-hmm. when the kids reached out to people, they didn't believe them."
The other thing that I think was so striking about this case is that parricide—that's where a child kills the parent, so either matricide or patricide. That is less than 1% of all homicides in the United States. I mean, it's a shockingly low number. And, you know, anybody that has been through that abuse, I think that Richard Jahnke said it best. If somebody's torturing you all your life, you will plot ways to kill him. You know, and I think a lot of people that have been through abuse may have had thoughts like that. But to actually act out on it, I mean, do you think that the community at large was just shocked in general by the fact that a child could be that violent against a parent?
Well, I think they were shocked, and many people were, you know, sort of siding with the parents in a way. It's like, mm-hmm. well, we can't let them get away with this because this is too scary. You're right, Clish. I mean, obviously, parricide is a very rare crime. I think if you look at the statistics of where you do actually have parricide cases, in almost all of those cases, unless there's either a history of child abuse or mental illness mm-hmm. or something that's going on, because that is a huge taboo to kill a parent. I mean, it's,
oh God, yeah,
it's not something that society has been able to overcome very easily. But usually there's something in the background like what was going on in this family, and the kids were literally feeling like it was going to be him or them. I mean, I think Richard in particular felt that it wasn't just the physical abuse, it was sort of the psychological situation that he was feeling like this was destroying him. And the only way he could resolve it was to take out this dad, who he had an exaggerated sense of his invulnerability. He had to put weapons all over the house. He had this image that he was going to be shooting and engaged in a gunfight with this guy throughout the house, that he wouldn't be able to bring him down with a single shot, which is exactly what he did, actually.
That was well put. I'm glad you said that, because I think people who are going to read the account and see that there were, what, 33 guns, I think, mm-hmm. in this home, that the youth, that Richard Jahnke, put them all over the house. I mean, the exaggerated sense of his father being completely invincible, that really hit me reading that he kept saying that he wasn't sure, you know?
Yeah, and of course, he had tried to report his father. He'd even gone to the sheriff's office at one point. He went to this ROTC instructor that he trusted, and the instructor did the right thing. Of all the adults that knew something about this, he actually did something about it. He took him to the sheriff's office. But the sheriff's office basically looked at the bruises and said, well, this isn't so bad,
yeah.
And we don't really have a group home we can fit you in right now, but we could put you in the jail overnight. You know, it's like he's the one who's reporting the abuser. He's the one that's expected to leave the home, not the father.
Yeah.
This was so different from the way a case like this would be handled then. I mean, if it was reported as child abuse, I mean, mm-hmm. This father would at least have to spend a night in jail, maybe something more serious depending on the charges that were filed.
Yeah.
But, you know, the prosecutors looked at this and said, well, look at all these guns. This was an ambush. This was not self-defense. He shot his father at a point where his father, he was not in immediate danger from his father at that particular moment. So he should be charged with first-degree murder, which is exactly what they did. And which belies, I think, the way abused kids look at their abuser. I mean, he had to shoot him that way. He had to ambush him that way because he thought he was so powerful.
Yeah.
You know, it's not as clear-cut as it seems.
Back then, do you think, Alan, that if they would not have taken such a hard line on the child, the son that shot his father, do you think that they're worried about setting a dangerous precedent that if we let him get away with this, he'll start a rash of parent killings across the nation?
It'll be open season on parents, yeah. I think there was a little bit of that concern. I mean, people knew that, I think there was the beginning of a sense that, you know, kids these days are out of control and, you know, there's too much access to weapons and all these violent movies and we really don't want to give these kids any ideas. Particularly if you're a hardliner parent. And I mean, Cheyenne's a pretty conservative community. There's a huge military presence.
Yeah.
I think there was a lot of concerns along those lines. Obviously, though, I mean, if they had kept the case in juvenile court and settled it quietly, the world would never have really heard about it. The world wouldn't have known all that was behind this case.
Well, what were you doing when this broke, Alan? I mean, what were you working on, and did you stop everything to cover this, or was this given to you as an assignment?
I did, sort of. I mean, what was interesting was that I had been looking at another parricide case. It was a historic case in Colorado where, again, you know, an upper-class family, the father was a doctor, a very beloved doctor, and the kid had killed both parents. And had been immediately branded a psychopath and sent off to, you know, prison for life. I mean, he was like 16 and gone into the adult prison system. And I thought this was a very interesting case because he later, he persuaded a governor who learned the true facts of the case from this kid's attorneys, commuted his sentence. And he went on to medical school and became a doctor working in a poor neighborhood. And I heard some details in this case. I thought, this is really fascinating because people just think of him as a monster. They don't realize what led up to this, which was a really horrendous family situation.
Mm-hmm.
And so I approached him, and I was thinking, you know, your story could be kind of important to people going through this kind of thing. And he just really wanted to be left alone. I mean, he had gone to prison rather than speak in court about what his parents had done to him. So I respected that, but I had been looking at that case, and then this thing came along, and I knew this was going to be a public trial, and I thought, okay, this may actually be a more contemporary version of the same thing, and the more I learned about it, the more I felt it was worth writing a book about.
Yeah, and a book you did. I mean, it is a great read. It really is. Clarissa read it in one day.
I stayed up till 2 in the morning. I could not put it down.
I read the first run way back when I was in high school. And I remember reading it. And we had a psychology teacher at the time. I'll never forget his name. His name was Mr. McAllister. And this guy was a character. He actually went to boot camp of Elvis Presley. And that was his claim to fame. But he pointed out this case to the class as what length someone that is psychologically stressed and breaking will go to, and what length the offender, the abuser, will go to make themselves look larger than life to keep control over the family. And really,
well, I think that's a great point too. You know, I mean, he did intimidate the family. He did. The mother very much had divided loyalties in all of this. You know, I think even the night that this all happened, I think her first impulse was really to side with the father and not tell people about what was going on in the house. You know, it's interesting to watch the dynamics of families caught in this kind of situation. Is this idea of being overly protective and you know, you can't really share this with the outside world because they're scarier than this, what's going on in our house.
Yeah, exactly. Tell them the beast is really outside. I'm just preparing you for the beast.
Circle the wagon.
It's ironic. The father was, in fact, telling Richard all this stuff about how horrible people were. He taught the son how to shoot. He taught him, don't trust anybody. He says, you got to defend the women. And essentially, he was defending the women the night he shot his father with the gun that his father showed him how to shoot. I mean, you know, it's. Mm-hmm. I think the guy kind of set up his own doom in some ways.
Hey, Eric.
Yes, Clarissa.
You remember, because I was too young to really remember what was going on and what the climate was when this case came out. But when you heard about this case, do you remember what the public sentiment was like or around where you were?
Yeah, I do. It was, I think, the initial reaction, very much like the Menendez brothers, mm-hmm. Which was closer to home because I was in Los Angeles in those days. It was the knee-jerk reaction is always against the killer, always against, in this case, we're talking about the child initially, because, oh my God, how could this happen? Some of the things you guys have already mentioned in terms of open season on parents, right? And people don't want that. And people really don't want to have to examine themselves and to think about all the times that they went over the line. You know, hey, have I crossed the line as a parent by being overly, let's say just by being violent? And of course, the farther back you go, the more quote unquote acceptable that was. And it was perceived as an internal family matter. And, you know, a lot of it's cultural. And we have a very good point that Joel made early on in this discussion was we really are in a different time. And so the initial reaction to that was, wow, you know, how can this be? How could that happen? My God, how psychotic the children must have been. But as the facts began to come out, as they leaked out, people were genuinely horrified. And part of it's internally a little bit of self-satisfaction, a little bit of a whew factor. Well, whew, I'm not that bad, at least. Oh, my goodness. You know, that kind of thing. So you kind of circle back around. And eventually, over time, people it sinks in and people realize, wow, these were just children. Mm-hmm. And we know what children are like. We have children. We know how impressionable. We know what we can imagine. We can envision what they were going through. Now, that doesn't mean they ended up necessarily agreeing with that final action. I think that's kind of yet another leap. Was that truly necessary? Was there truly no other way out? And I think you would have some division on that. But in terms of sympathy, in terms of understanding, I think that did come, at least to a certain extent, over time. So that would be my general assessment of the temperature at that time. Does that make sense to you, Alan?
Well, it does. You mentioned the Menendez case. I have a postscript about that. That was several years later, and by that time, I think a lot of people in the public were more cognizant about child abuse and, in fact, more cynical about the abuse defense being raised by people like the Menendez brothers. Mm-hmm. But what was interesting about that trial was they were testifying about all these terrible things their father did to them, and after a while, some of that testimony started to seem familiar.
Oh.
And actually it came out in the press that they were cadging some of their stories from other abuse accounts. And there's a couple of things they mentioned that actually happened to Richard Jahnke. They read the poison tree as part of their preparation for their abuse defense.
Oh,
which I thought was a really weird kind of
a tribute to you, huh?
Oh.
Well, but I mean, you know, it's the Menendez brothers, so it was a little creepy. But,
oh yeah, I was gonna say it comes a little creep factor, you know, that kind of homage to you.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at their testimony, they say things about, oh, and my dad would throw me into the pool trying to teach me how to swim, and I was scared of drowning. These are things that were stolen almost word for word from things that Richard had said.
Huh.
In the Jahnke case. So I thought that was really interesting. They had to sort of manufacture their trauma from other people's accounts of actual abuse, which was interesting. So,
and the Menendez boys, if I'm not mistaken, happened in the 1990s. What, mid-90s, right, guys? If I'm not mistaken, it's been so long ago.
Yeah.
And they had they gunned down their parents. Basically, these are two boys with silver spoons in their mouths. gunned down their parents. And for anyone that's listening and is not familiar with that case, and you can, of course, Google the Menendez case, and you will read, and you will actually see what Alan is saying. There's a lot of similarities if you read the testimonies. You're not even joking, Alan. Because I was going over the Menendez case.
They literally lifted stuff from my book and from a couple of other books about different child abuse cases.
Yes.
In order to build a bogus child abuse defense.
It really, going over it, and I thought maybe I'd go back to that case just to kind of see a progression of how things changed the media from that case. And then reading the testimony, I think it was Lyle if I can, Lyle, one of the boys, and I think he was the one to first try that. And I thought to myself, holy crap, I wonder where they got that from. And of course, getting ready for the show. And I wanted to bring that up. I'm glad you brought that up, that they were trying to use that in their defense. But thank God they did not successfully get off of murder. We got to run a break. When we come back, don't go anywhere. We're going to dig deeper and go further down the rabbit hole with these unfortunate cases and more about this particular case. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back right after this. Hey, you're listening to After Hours AM, and if you're listening to us via podcast, make sure you like us, follow us, review us, tell your friends about us, tell grandma about us, and keep listening.
Hi, Tom Baudet. If pop culture is to be believed, roughly 40% of all people are actually vampires, or dating one. Well, undead or not, you can always save on a clean, comfortable room at Motel 6, even if you sleep during the day because direct sunlight turns you into a pile of sparkly coffee grounds. Speaking of which, we have free coffee every morning. You day sleepers may want to go for the decaf. I'm Tom Baudet, and we'll leave the light on for you. Book online at motel6.com.
Anavar Media LLC is a dedicated team of professionals committed to helping business development scale and protect their websites, mobile applications, enterprise software solutions in the Northeast Ohio area. Locally owned since 2012, our client-centered values truly sets Anavar apart. Contact us today to learn how you can get 25% off your first project. Call them at 234-380-4852. Again, that's 234-380-4852. Or visit them at www.anavar.com. Again, that's www.anavar.com.
Taking a family of five to the amusement park can cost a small fortune.
Oh, yeah. So to save some money, we thought, hey, let's bring the amusement park to us. Yeah. Go ahead.
All right. Step right up. Step right up, young man. Are you ready to ride the Wacky Waterfall?
That's just the bathtub with the shower head running.
Nope, it's the Wacky Waterfall.
It's the shower, Dad.
Waterfall.
Wacky.
There's an easier way to save. To get a free rate quote, go to geico.com. Then buy online, over the phone, or at your local Geico office.
Hey, everybody, this is Joel Sturgis. Did you know that After Hours AM and America's Most Haunted have a great new website out there? You're going to want to visit americas-most-haunted.com. There you can get all the new content from all the writers for America's Most Haunted, as well as the great haunted headlines everybody loves each and every week, as well as catch After Hours AM live right there, along with podcasts, past shows, and get to know your hosts as well as contact us all in one stop. You're going to love it. You're not going to want to go anywhere else. So come to americas-most-haunted.com today. You're listening to After Hours AM, the best in alternative talk radio. Got a question, comment, guest suggestion, or just want to say hi? Contact us at afterhoursam@gmail.com. That's afterhoursam@gmail.com. Want to call the show and be interactive? That's easy. The number is 612-326-6874. Again, the number is 612-326-6874. And thank you for listening. And welcome back to After Hours AM, everybody. Before we jump back into this, I think it's really important that we give out the national hotline for domestic violence, 1-800-799-7233. Again, 1-800-799-7233. If you're experiencing violence in your life done by a family member in the domestic setting, that one, you call them, you call that number, or call 911. Don't be ashamed. It happens a lot to everybody in all walks of life, we're finding out. So you are truly not alone. But I am your host, Joel Sturgis, of course. We're back, and I'm with
Eric Olsen and
Dr. Clarissa Cole.
And when we were leaving and we were kind of talking about this case, and we brought up some great points during the break. And, you know, oftentimes during the show, folks, guys listening, you all know this, we come up with these great questions we wish we would have asked on air. And that's no exception here. Now, my question to both of you guys, to Alan and, of course, Dr. Cole, is did Stockholm Syndrome play a role in why they didn't run?
You knew them, so what do you think?
I think that you grow up learning to be very protective in that kind of environment. And I think part of it was, I think by the time the killing happened, and again, we're talking about 16, 17 years old, they no longer had some of those particular limitations. I mean, the sense that they had to stay and keep quiet about everything. But it was a little scary because there was really nowhere to go. I mean, you know, the police weren't providing them with any alternatives. They really didn't trust social workers or anybody like that. I think there's, you know, and a lot of victims are very protective of their abusers because they don't know anything else. The world outside, they think, is even scarier.
And this, just to remind the listeners, this was a case that was really kind of a seminal case in the 80s with Richard Jahnke and his sister, Deborah Jahnke. They were tried separately after Richard shot their father, who was abusing them horribly. But what was so interesting about that and so poignant about that question, Joel, is that they were tried as adults. Mm-hmm. And, you know, everybody out there knows now that so much work has been done in the psychological arena with victims of abuse, and it can be a legitimate defense. But the thought of trying a 15 or 16-year-old kid who's been horribly abused as an adult as though a regular 15-year-old kid without any abuse still doesn't have the cognitive, you know, they don't have the brain of an adult. So the thought of treating somebody who's also been horribly abused and horribly sheltered as an adult is just, it's unthinkable. It really is.
Getting to the weapon that he used as a hunter, I am a deer hunter and a bear hunter, and I live in the wilds of northern Minnesota, so I am very well versed in firearms. The weapon he chose, a 12-gauge of the slug. Now, folks, a 12-gauge slug is bigger than your thumb. It's a very large bullet. So when it hits its target, intended target, it is not like on TV where it's a little bit of blood. I'm talking horror show kind of impact. And that speaks that he was truly afraid just by the firearm he chose. Something with that devastation.
The conditions under which the shooting took place, he was waiting in the garage. His parents were coming up the driveway. The garage door was down. He basically was firing at a shadow. He did not want to physically face his father through the garage door. And because he was a good shot, he had ROTC training, really dropped him with that very first shot. And interestingly, blew his ROTC whistle as he did it. I mean, it was sort of a way of ritualizing this and seeing himself as a man or something as he did this. He really had to psych himself into doing this. And, you know, obviously, it's not to say this was the right solution to the situation. If you asked Richard today whether he did the right thing, he'll tell you, no, that was totally the wrong thing to do. Mm-hmm. He's never felt that that was the right thing to do. He just felt like he didn't realize that he had other options at that point. I think he really felt trapped.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, doesn't that part argue
to deal with the dynamics of the situation?
Doesn't the fact that he blew the plastic whistle that he was given in ROTC, doesn't that argue to the fact of how much of a kid he still was, though, you know?
I think, yes, I, think it does. And his sister was in even worse shape. I mean, the sad thing to me is, even if you can understand why they would try Richard for murder, for that kind of ambush killing, his sister did nothing to really advance this so-called conspiracy. I mean, she's just sitting in the house. She's kind of a basket case with all these weapons around her, with Richard thinking, well, if I fail, at least she'll have a chance to defend herself. Well, I doubt she would have picked up one of those guns or done anything with it. She was not in any kind of shape to do that. But she got charged as an accessory and essentially also, got a stiff sentence out of it, which had to later be commuted by the governor.
That, okay, you got these terrified people, the kids, the mother, of course, had to have been just absolutely traumatized by what had gone down, and automatically her default setting would have been to, support her husband, because that's who she loved, that's who she married to. But then to hear about a young lady sitting in the living room, just I'm telling the listeners, just think about that. You have two people, one of them is the shooter, and the other one, in case he misses, they have a backup shooter. That's how terrified they really were. And that speaks volumes to the climate in that home, the way that they were treated as a family, the abuse that took place behind the scenes that not many people really either heard about or didn't want to do anything about. The ball got dropped, not once, not twice, but many, many times where the warning signs were there. Now, some of this in my mind, and maybe I'm reaching, falls on the head of law enforcement. They could have stopped this tragedy. It wasn't like they didn't go to him.
Well, that's true. There was a point where Richard reported his father to the sheriff's office. They brought his father in. They had this rather kind of brief meeting with the family. And then they sent them all home, and a social worker comes to visit a few weeks later and never talks to Richard alone. I mean, he talks to Richard in front of his father, which I think anybody who's involved in abuse investigations would know that was totally the wrong thing to do. Mm-hmm. But they got the message pretty clearly that the sheriff's office, law enforcement, social services were not that interested in their problems. And so I think they felt they had to work it out among themselves. And that's where the tragedy really began, yeah.
Well, even the court system, I was talking about that a little bit on the break, too. Even the lead prosecutor and the judge. I'm going to read just a tiny little excerpt from what you have written, Alan. So Carol was the prosecutor, and he promptly challenged the severity and frequency of the beatings Richard claimed. He produced a photograph of Richard's bruises taken after the May incident. That's what we were just talking about. And asked if he could see any serious damage there other than the red marks on his back. Nothing visible, Richard said. You wouldn't be able to see my heart. That kills me.
Well, that was a very spontaneous moment in the courtroom, and it just blew people away. Because that's really what was at the heart of the case. It was not that he was defending himself in a classic sense of self-defense where he was threatened with immediate bodily injury. This was a situation where the psychological abuse was so much more damaging than even the beatings, and made to feel worthless all the time, made to feel like, you are just a burden on the world and you should die or go away. I think that was really what drove Richard in particularly over the edge, was the degree in which he was humiliated, constantly belittled, and made to feel worthless.
But the fact that a 16-year-old
was going to go crazy and he had to do something.
But the fact that a 16-year-old was pointing that out to all the adults in the courtroom, I mean, did that seem ironic to you at all?
Oh, sure, sure. But I thought there were a lot of truths that sometimes come out of the mouths of babes, and in court in particular. I mean, it's a very scripted performance often by lawyers, and you have a sort of young, naive defendant like that, he may say things that will make people gasp because it's not scripted.
Boy, I'm looking at these things there. It's making me cringe the deeper I get into the whole court, the notes of the courtroom, and of course the prosecutor says the boy fired six times, striking the father four times, the fatal shot killing him in the right chest and severing his aorta. Wow. Six times. I mean, that, you know, a lot of people talk about on the show, a crime's a passion. You know, I mean, when someone's stabbed several times, it's automatically thought to be a crime of passion. When you hear this many shots going off, that's shooting out of fear. And that's something I imagine was not lost in the courtroom.
Well, you know, I asked Richard, where did you get this idea about putting weapons all over the house? And one of the things that he had seen shortly before that was the movie, the original Conan the Barbarian movie with Arnold. I mean, this is dating this back to the early 80s, right? Arnold Schwarzenegger. And in that movie, Conan puts a bunch of weapons in a backup position when he knows he's going to be attacked by this horde. And you know, it sort of says something about the kid's state of mind that one bullet's not going to kill this guy. I'm going to have to shoot this guy again and again. And I'm going to run from this weapon to this weapon to this weapon because he's invincible. It's going to take, you know, dozens of shots to bring him down.
Yeah, yeah, like he's facing some type of monster, not a mortal man.
Yeah, yeah, I really think, you know, if you try to get into the mindset of what a scared, abused 16-year-old kid's going through, I mean, it's really different from the way an adult looks at the same situation.
Sure. Well, Clarissa, what would your professional workup be if this kid was in front of you in a jail setting? Where would you be in your mindset?
Obviously, he has, you know, so much traumatic abuse. What's interesting, though, Joel, and this is so strange how, you know, how the world just kind of comes full circle. Alan, you had just mentioned Conan the Barbarian. Well, Arnold Schwarzenegger was the governor of California for a while. And while he was the governor of California, he started this legislation. It didn't pass while he was in office, but he started the legislation about California youth offenders, which takes into account the diminished culpability of juveniles when they commit violence because of their brain development and the fact that they have not been exposed to the world, especially in cases of abuse. So if I was sitting and evaluating Richard Jahnke today, part of how I would think about it is in this sense of using that youth offender statute to make sure that I wasn't judging him under the same standard that I would as an adult. And kind of weirdly, Arnold Schwarzenegger actually had something to do with that.
Oh, interesting.
Well, you know, and then there's the other side of the pendulum where people think that kids are getting off too easy. I've also heard that argument. In fact, some of the listeners are weighing in, of course. And of course, you can weigh in too. You email us, call us, do whatever you want to do. But they're hitting me on Facebook saying, well, you know, what about these offenders that are juveniles and they know they're juveniles and do crime knowing they'll get away with it?
In gang situations, I think that that is true. I would agree with that, actually. I think that there are a lot of people that are sentenced that are part of gangs in urban settings that it seems like it's just a revolving door in the juvenile system. You know what I mean? It's like they go in for a few months, they come out, they immediately commit another crime. And it seems like they're never rehabilitating them. And it just gets worse and worse until it escalates to the point of something like murder. But that type of juvenile offender, again, this goes back to exactly what we were talking about much earlier in the show, this whole idea of one size fits all. And one size does not fit all. That type of juvenile offender, somebody who is habituated in antisocial behavior, is not like someone like Richard Jahnke, which is that's a totally different type of offender. And I would say you need to look at them as individuals and judge accordingly.
Yeah,
worked against Richard was, you know, it was not really an insanity defense. It was given the situation, it was in many ways a very rational thing, what he did. Mm-hmm. You know, if you had that set of facts and you had that perception of the world, how would you respond? And there was a total disconnect between that and the way the justice system looks at the same set of facts, and particularly the way the prosecutors looked at it. And they were saying, well, why couldn't you just run away? Why couldn't you just do 20 other things rather than do this, which was the worst possible thing you could have done? And, you know, I think it just doesn't take into account who these kids are.
Yeah. And I can only imagine a level of fear, you know, because I don't come from an abused home. I've never been abused, thank God. And I've never had to deal with that. I just imagine being in that situation. I mean, or rather, I couldn't imagine it because, like I said, never put up with it. I just couldn't imagine that stress. Because one of the things that was said in court really hit me hard, that the defense attorney said that his father had killed him inch by inch, day by day, month by month, and year by year, was one of the defense used. And there, I think reading that, I do believe you could break somebody doing that. You could take them to that level to want to kill.
Well, this was a father. I mean, you know, again, I think there was a lot of skepticism. People were saying, well, how do we know half this stuff even happened?
Yeah.
And it really took a lot of research to sort of find people who knew something about this family and had met this guy and you know, could say, look, you don't really understand how it was. This guy was a very sadistic fellow. Mm-hmm. I mean, he really had issues with control. He really had ways of humiliating his children and traumatizing them and alternately being very brutal to his wife and then mm-hmm. very romantic, this whole sort of makeup cycle that domestic abusers go through with their wives sometimes. And there was not any real chance that was going to change. I mean, this guy mm-hmm. was sort of set in this pattern from an early age. I mean, I don't think that means he deserved to be killed, but
yeah.
But I think it did sort of sow the seeds of what was going to happen here. And yeah, killing him inch by inch, I think that's actually pretty accurate.
Well, if people have not read the book, The Poison Tree, I thought that it was a remarkable account on several levels, not just because it goes through every bit of the case, but I did want to say, Alan, that I felt like you gave a very fair portrait to each person involved, and I think that that would have been particularly difficult with Maria, the mother, just because I think that in some ways she's sympathetic, but in other ways to some people she's not. And I just wanted to say I thought that the representation that you did of her was more than fair, and it was a pleasure to read. So I hope you guys go out there and read it. It is on Kindle, Amazon.
All right, one question remains, my friends. For those who don't know, what happened? What was the result?
Well, that's interesting because, in a way, you know, it's a lifetime story. They were both sentenced to prison, and then the governor of Wyoming at the time, Ed Hirschler, stepped in and commuted the sentences. Richard spent some time in a juvenile facility, and then went back to his mother's house. She was still living in the same house. And Deborah spent some time at a youth facility in Denver, really not a correctional facility, more like a treatment facility. And they both went on with their lives. I'm still in touch with them. They've changed their names because of the notoriety of the case. They've certainly had some challenges over the years as they start their own families. But I talk to Richard, I think, more frequently than I hear from Deborah, and he's doing pretty well. I mean, I think he was determined not to be the kind of father that his own father was, and he's mm-hmm. done well at that.
I'm so glad to hear that.
Yeah, that's...
We'll break the cycle. Exactly.
Very important. No, all right, hey!
I think that's what people who've been through that and know just how horrible it is, that's what they really want to do, is head off in a new direction.
All right, we need to know, since you are not just this case and not just this book that you wrote 30 years ago. You're a legendary true crime writer. What are you working on right now? What are your most recent projects? Let us know.
Well, I have over the years done a fair amount of writing about JonBenet Ramsey. Mm-hmm. That's a case that has been 20 years in the not solving, which is still out there. I'm doing some work on solitary confinement issues, which is something I spend a lot of time reporting about crimes inside prison, and certainly solitary is an interesting issue in itself in terms of what it does to folks. I've spent time over the years writing about Columbine. I haven't done much about that lately, which is also another case that went on and on and on, partly because the families involved were trying to get answers that the authorities really didn't want to give mm-hmm. about what they knew about those kids, the killers, before the Columbine happened. Those cases have all kept me pretty busy, actually.
What is your take on JonBenet? We've actually covered that, and Clarissa gave us a very interesting dissertation on it. What are your thoughts on the case?
Well, there are really only two important developments that I think have happened in the last decade or so with that case, and both of them point to, I guess you would say, law enforcement and the justice system letting us all down. Mm-hmm. One was the revelation that the grand jury had wanted to indict the parents for child abuse resulting in death in 1999. We didn't know about that. The DA covered that up, said there wasn't enough information to charge anybody, and misled us about that for many years until that came out just a couple of years ago. And the more recent revelation is that the subsequent DA who exonerated the Ramseys on the basis of touch DNA misrepresented what the DNA was about, and the exoneration may be something less than a clear-cut exoneration. So I think, you know, anybody that deals with the case has to deal with those two facts, which both suggest that the government really doesn't want this case to be solved.
The DNA was fascinating to me because I had just read recently that they were, first of all, they were only using four markers out of the DNA anyway, which the minimum...
Not enough to really do anything with legal.
Yeah, I mean, how do you rule somebody... I had read, I don't know, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I'd read somewhere that the DNA was actually, the one DNA sample from that unknown male, wasn't it actually a commingled sample of more than one person?
Yes. In other words, this is another problem with this case from the beginning, with all the tainted evidence.
Yeah.
And this thing that they were using is sort of like the holy grail. If we find the person that matches this DNA, this unknown male, we found the killer. Turns out not to be true either. I mean, this is just a mess. This is more sort of meaningless DNA because it's got too many different sources and it doesn't really mean anything. And it could have been there in any number of ways. It's not a definitive artifact of the crime scene.
Yeah.
So it's not a case that I think is going to be definitively solved unless we find some new way of dealing with DNA, and of course they're advancing in their detection procedures all the time, but something else would have to come to the forefront to really have the physical evidence to wade through all of the spin that's been put on this case over the years.
All that's interesting, but who did it?
You're not going to get me saying that.
Well, it's funny.
I will say that I have trouble with the intruder theory because, well, I've never seen any evidence of an intruder that made any sense, particularly one that would come in, use the implements in the house to write that ransom note, that very long War and Peace of ransom notes, do all this other stuff, and mysteriously disappear without a trace. It just doesn't make any
sense. which was funny because didn't they point the finger shortly at someone that was disabled, mentally challenged in the home? Or am I totally off air? Maybe Clarissa and I were talking about that off air, that maybe she thought it could have been someone mentally challenged.
There was, well, before the like verbiage of the note came out, there was somebody that was peripherally, I mean, connected to the family. I was always kind of wondering about the guy that played Santa Claus, though.
Don't blame Santa. Yeah, he gets a bad rap.
Whose mobility is such that he could not possibly have climbed in that window, trust me. I know people that knew him. He's since deceased, but I think he was just somebody else to be thrown under the bus at one point or another in this case. It's a sad case because I don't have a coherent theory about which person in the house did what, but everything that I've seen so far does not, to me, support the idea of this mysterious intruder out of the blue who somehow came in and did all these terrible things to that girl.
Yeah, yeah. I kind of lean the same way you are. And there's so much information that has been crossed. I mean, it's like they get close to it and it's like they back off. I was actually asking an investigator we know really well that we've had on the show, you know, who he thought he has done it, and he says, you know what, there's more clear pictures of Bigfoot than there are of any evidence of this. So really, it's the deal, like you said, maybe they don't want it solved.
Well, I think, you know, there have been some very sincere efforts. There have been some good books about this case from people who are involved in the investigation at one point or another. I thought Steve Thomas's book was pretty interesting. I thought Jim Kohler's book, Foreign Faction, was interesting because he was one of the first people to try to deal with these DNA contradictions. And, you know, I mean, you either have to discount the DNA or you have to believe there are five or six people involved in this, you know, with all these traces of different unknown DNA.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Maybe the small foreign faction was, in fact, you know, a whole circus troupe of midgets or something that came in and did it. I don't know. But someone did it, damn it. The people who are interested in this case might want to start with Steve Thomas's and Jim Kohler's books.
All right.
Well said. Well, we are back. We're done with another show. And, of course, I'd like to thank Alan Prendergast for coming on the show, giving us his take on true crime and, of course, covering the sensational cases of child abuse, which is always hard for everyone to listen to and actually hard for us to talk about. Thank you so much, Alan, for coming and talking with us about this. You know, again, it is such a horrible act of violence, but does happen in a lot of homes across the country, across the world. So if you are a victim, you seek help, get the help you need, and take care of yourself, each other, and take care of each love another. Remember, there's no place for violence in a family. Gosh darn it, talk it out. On behalf of myself, Joel Sturgis, of course, Mr. Eric Olsen, the beautiful and talented Dr. Clarissa Cole, take care of each other, love each other. Until next time, read some more true crime books.
Thank you for listening to this edition of After Hours AM, and please remember to like us on Facebook and also follow us over on Twitter.